Welcome back, everyone, to the potential last game of the D2CL Season 5 Grand Finals. And yeah, currently, Team Empire is 2-0 up, something a lot of people would have not expected to happen. However, it did happen. They have been dominant yesterday, making VG drop down to the lower bracket. VG had to fight their way back up, which didn't seem to be a massive problem for them. But now they're faced with a wall of good plays, amazing supports. What can they do?
Going into the past game, I think the big problem I saw with VG's lineup is that they were not really into their 4-5 position. I feel like the positions that they ran on FY and on Fenrir, they should have been swapped around. I feel like that a Visage to me is a clear 4 position, whereas Fenrir should be, and he is, his role is the 5 position, and he clearly shows that usually, whereas he buys all the wards and provides all the vision, moves around, has as little items as possible if the game is not going well. Where FY, where he plays the lion role, he's not going to do that, because he's known to take a lot of farm. He plays the most like farm efficient 4 most likely in the world, where you can't do that with a Visage in return, where he can't play the clear 5. And I feel like that's a struggle of their draft, and hopefully they can change that with a upcoming game.
And we will see if they can or not, as we are heading into the picks and bans. So guys, take it away.
That's right, the draft is already underway, so VG Gaming will move to the Dire side, Team Empire to the Radiant side, and Resolution once again looking to get the upper hand in the drafting phase. Banning out Gyrocopter himself this time around, taking up the Undying 2, while VG Gaming, they're giving respect ban here to Yoki. The Earthshaker within the first two, taking up the Wisp as well. It frees up the Quap, but Beastmaster for Resolution has now arrived.
Yeah, and I think it's one of the heroes too that Empire runs so well. In terms of strategy, they just overrun teams with the vision and just being able to get active on the map. And something I also want to point out as well that I like about Empire's style against Vichy's is they assault on all fronts, Toby. It's like we'll be watching Ice die at top and simultaneously a gank is happening mid. Uh-huh. Like it's actually impossible without two monitors to be able to spot what's going on in both fields right now.
You're starting to make me feel better, Blitz.
No, it's true because I'm actually watching it out as well, and there's just not enough time to switch between the cameras because all of a sudden Resolution's getting a solo kill mid while Ice is dying at top. Mm-hmm. And so if you're Vichy Gaming, how do you stop the bleeding?
Well, not by playing up against a Disruptor when you got a Queen of Pain. That's not one way to help the bleeding. It's, again, Aloha Dance. It's really just been his hero of the competition. He's going to have all the vision in the world too, which is great when you got Glimpse.
Yes.
You need to keep that vision up with the Hawk. There is still the downside about the Beastmaster Hawk, the repositioning now. The Hawk is a lot slower, so you can't run into the team fights and just have the Hawk in front of you the entire time because it doesn't move fast enough. But if you got the Hawk up for vision, it's all about the counter initiation, so it's all about seeing where the Beastmaster Hawk's going to be prepared first, and then Empire set up for the fight. I don't want to say it should be a full counter initiation, because Team Empire have already proven that their rotations across the map have been very successful, and that at this point, they're playing as a superior team. So if they can keep this momentum, if they can keep this mindset, they can actually chase VG Gaming down, and don't give them that time to let the greedier drafts really kick in.
Yeah, so Team Empire, the Disruptor and the Beastmaster pick up for them. These are heroes that we've seen them pick all weekend. Queen of Pain is the hero for Vichy Gaming. This is a hero that I feel like super plays super well. And it gives them options as well, because Hao can play it. And it's just a lane dominating hero. And I feel like even with the Disruptor in the game, you can still pick it because of what it provides for you. You get a ultimate that goes through BKB. Mm-hmm. You've got the Dagger, which is a lane dominator.
It's a great hero all around, and you can't really fault VG Gaming as far as their draft so far. Like, if you got a Vengeful, you got a Quap, everything's looking good. There's potential for combos later on. You could still just go for the more standard kind of combo with a little bit of a push, so you stack up a little bit of the auras with the Vengeful Spirit. You could, if you want to go into the Drow on the Visage, if you want to go down that line, which Resolution's now going to say no to by banning out the Drow. As VG Gaming start to look at the other control heroes, a Disruptor Rubick combo, they're not playing up against this again. They refuse to let the Axe come through, and Team Empire, they keep banding up against Ice. Again, we see this Broodmother being taken out of the pool. The Undying is kind of for Ice as well, but it's going to be a rough offlane for Ice.
Yeah, and whatever he has to play against so far, this entire tournament has been absolutely rough, and Vengeful Spirit is the pickup for Vichy Gaming. I like this. I think that what they have to do to win this game is get aggressive in the lanes, try to make ganks happen, try to win one lane completely uncontested. Because what we've seen every single game is that Yoki doesn't die in the offlane. They kept going for rotations on the mid lane that weren't successful in the last game. And they've attempted that all throughout this weekend on Resolution. But his positioning has been so good, Toby, that they haven't really been able to break any sort of entrances. And so I think with the Vengeful Spirit and the Queen of Pain, you can start to get aggressive in multiple lanes.
Okay, I can understand that. But you're still going to need a follow-up. Like, that for me is the biggest thing. Like, so where is your damage going to come? Like, the co-op and the VS, if you want them to split up and move around different lanes, then you need to have multiple dual combos to come into the next part of the draft. I know we're in the hands of Empire right now, so it's up to Resolution. What's going to be our next way? And I'm wondering, too, if Resolution keeps drafting the way he was drafting before, where you have, like, just these strong support combinations. Or does he try and play the global game? I know I haven't mentioned it much, but like Resolution's Tinker is very, very good. Do we start combining it up with other things like we saw Supers Invoker once during this competition so far, I believe. I don't think there's going to be another Invoker. But also Resolution plays a wonderful Invoker. So do we start going down this line and we say, okay, let's push the Beastmaster to the off lane and play that kind of road?
I'm not actually sure. Just depends on what they really want. In terms of the lane matchups, I think that's where Empire have consistently tried to play around, is that where do we have the stronger lanes? Where can we exploit this? And Shadow Demon is the pickup for Team Empire. And again, another comfort hero for Always Wanna Fly. We saw him play this hero with great success against VG Gaming in the game where he paired with, it was Yoki's Axe in the offlane. Mm-hmm. And I think VG Gaming have learned their lesson from that one and banning out the Axe almost immediately. And so VG Gaming, I mean, their most successful heroes so far this tournament have been shut down by Team Empire. You've got Hao on the Weaver, was unsuccessful. He played the Lifestealer, got absolutely crushed that game. The one game where you kind of saw success was the Phantom Lancer game, but then the game immediately after that, you got stomped again. And so I think VG Gaming especially have kind of hit this wall where they're probably a little bit less confident. And so in terms of what they pick up as their carry, I think that's where they're going to struggle a little bit.
Do you try and then exploit that lack of confidence? Do you move back into this aggro trial lane that we've seen already today and bring the SD, maybe something like a Lashrak together with a Disruptor and try and get up in the face of VG Gaming, take out their early towers and move on? I know that was NIP running that kind of draft, especially now that you're running a Chen. So potentially, if you can move aggressively into the enemy jungle, you can shut down the Chen and just control the entire northern part of the map.
I think that's your goal if you're Team Empire right now. Because in every single game we've seen them play so far, because Chen's not the best level 1 hero, they invade the jungle, they try to get in there as fast as possible, set up wards, establish vision, and just limit the amount of movement that the Chen can have. And so I expect Empire to at least play aggressively into the jungle. They don't necessarily have to do something like an aggressive tri-lane, which I feel if you lose the aggro tri-lane in a game like this with the Beastmaster as your core, you just straight up lose the game.
Yep.
So I think that you could see a dual lane, and if they sense the fact that maybe Vici pick a really greedy carry, they might be able to go aggressive, but I think dual lanes are the way to go. I think if you're Empire, you take something that can kind of pressure into the offlane, and so Sand King is the pickup for them.
This is such a flexible hero to pick up. It's one of Yoki's favorites as well as Always Wanna Fly's, but it's probably going to be played by Yoki in this game, and it lets you do whatever lane you want. Like, even if Queen of Pain goes up against the Sand King and we end up having, like, this offlane Queen of Pain ice up against SK and he runs a safe lane, you're still going to be able to battle that lane perfectly because you just use Sandstorm and you dodge it. The Shadow Strike, that is. So I love the SK. Remember, too, SK got a rework on his Caustic Finale during the recent patch. So his pushing power became a lot better, too.
Yeah, so Sand King, I think, is really good against heroes like Queen of Pain as well, where you're not the tankiest. You rely on getting items that snowball you into the game, but one blink stun pretty much just ruins your life. So we'll see the direction they decide to go. I think Sand King as well is a good aggressive hero for them. It seems like Yoki is really comfortable playing that aggressive strength type of hero.
Mm-hmm.
And so VG Gaming, like we said, here's that Phantom Lancer. And it's something I expected because it's the hero that they've had success against Empire with.
It just feels a little greedy in a way because now I'm not feeling a lot of presence on that top lane. And if you do go into something like, I don't know, like, just the little Shrak or the Mirana, like, both could work with the Shadow Demon, and you can control the PL. Like, you can doppelganger away from the Disruptor, which is really nice, but if that initial stun connects before PL can react to it, then he's going to drop. And what's the VS going to do? You technically, yes, you can start swapping out heroes, but yeah, I'm concerned for him. And you see the Titan to ban. This really does just reek of Team Empire aggro tri-lane.
Yeah, and so Team Empire, they've got one more pick to go. This is the hero that Silent needs to play. I think last time they picked the Luna, and I think it could have worked, but if not for the type of build that he opted to go for. So I think that if they decide to go that route again, yes, it can be successful. No, you can't go a mech on Luna again. But I think that there are a lot of heroes right now that could work out for him. I mean, they could take... I think they need some sort of BKB carry just to deal with the PL's mana burn. I think that anything like... I'm trying to think right now off the top of my head. They could get any sort of the heroes with passives right now because there's not a Silver Edge carrier.
Or do you just try and force the win earlier on? Like, you're talking about like what happens if you have to take the PL on the Queen of Pain in the mid-game. What if you just force the lanes out?
You could go for that as well. I just don't think that Empire is that all-in of a team. It doesn't feel like that anyways. I think that they like to leave themselves some options and keep themselves a little bit open. I don't know, man. Go old school. Pick an AM. That'll be funny. I would enjoy that.
I think the rest of the world would enjoy that. If you're really creating the laning, though, and you can get away with running dual lanes in that scenario.
Yeah, and I think that Vici kind of lack some crowd control, but no, Sven is going to be the pickup for them. They needed some sort of heavy damage to their... I was thinking AM because I think they need something to be able to cleave and at the same time be difficult to kill, but you've got a hero that accomplishes that in both functions with the Sven.
He literally has that ability, except it's a great cleave.
Yeah.
As opposed to a basic cleave. Oh, it's solid lineup from Team Empire. Their team fight's actually crazy too, because anyone that gets locked in with that disruptor ulti and wall, Sven is just going to carve apart. And PL can't escape from that. And PL's not a BKB builder, so he's not going to build a BKB to get away from the disruptor. And if he does get as a late game luxury item, you potentially should have already won the game. And also, Aghanim Scepter would more than likely be already up on Loha Dance. So. I like to pick up from Empire. The draft looks solid, and Nature's Prophet will be the last one from VG Gaming. One of Ice's old classic heroes. Very difficult to sneak up on his Prophet because his micro is so good with the treants.
Yeah, and that's something I want to talk about in depth. It's just the fact that Ice, when he plays this hero, it feels like he's ungankable. Like, I've played against it before. He sends one treant in one direction, he sends another, and at every single time that it's going to be up, you just see five treants marching across the map, and it makes you so smoke heavy. And it kind of counteracts that style of the Beastmaster where they have to start running around with smokes. And so the Nature's Prophet, though, it's kind of telling for Vici Gaming. I think what they're going to try to do is split out the map, keep things relatively even going into the laning phase by using the Chen pretty aggressively, and then just create space so that Ice, and Hao can kind of play that split farm, force Empire into a do-or-die kind of scenario game.
As you can see, we had Silent underneath his desk, so... There was just an audio problem by the looks of it for VG Gaming, more than anything, for Team Empire. But they'll unpause in a moment. And, man, this split push, potentially it could be wonderful for VG Gaming. The concern I'm having is, again, the timing before these heroes come online. Like, Nature's Prophet, we're seeing more and more of it. Like, I know we said before, like, if you don't have a Quelling Blade or a Tango up against Nature's Prophet in the early stages, then it's a real disaster for you. But Prophet still needs more time before he can be a good pusher. Before Queen of Pain can come online, she needs to find levels probably more than anything else. And then you've got the Phantom Lancer on top of that, who also requires time to farm. Like, you might want to go for this Diffuser Blade, but you're still going to be wanting like Vladimir's and then Diffuser Blade after, like, before that point. Or Treads and something else to sustain him.
I think if Vici Gaming kind of have... They go relatively even into the mid-game. They should have a lot of advantages just because of the fact that they can split up across the map. And Empire doesn't have the most mobile cores. Like, Sven is a pretty static hero. It's not the best at going for pickoffs and stuff like that. And yeah, the Sand King can do it, but every single time you're going to go for a kill, for example, on Ice, you're going to commit the ultimate, or you're going to commit the ultimate to kill the Phantom Lancer. So things are going to be a little bit static for them. So I think what Empire have to do is try to get as quick of an advantage as they can in the laning phase, get the ball rolling, look for pickoffs, invade the jungle. And that's what they've been doing so well against most junglers, is that they invade the jungle from the get-go, they put pressure on Fenrir, and they make it difficult in the laning phase then. And so, I mean, what this comes down to, I feel, is if the Chen has a good game and can create space for Vici Gaming, then they're liable to win. And if he can't, then I feel like they're just kind of deadlocked and they don't really have presence on the map at all.
So for most of the time at the start of this game, we should be looking at the access in to the jungle. That's
exactly
the primary place we look at. We're going to do a cap thing right now.
Okay.
A very, very capish thing. While they're doing their things, we do an effigy check.
Oh, I already know these. This is hilarious. Empire has like the funniest. Yeah, it's like it's so bad. It's just Black Holt and it's just him holding his hands up, like always want to fly. It's like the funniest thing I've ever seen, and I don't know why. And then Yoki has one.
I don't understand why he's not using an inscription for it.
I don't know. It's just so random.
It doesn't even make any sense why he's doing it. Like, you could have actually put like Hot Shoe Shuffle or something like that onto this.
Yeah, it's adorable. It's just Black Hold. Like that's that's what his effigy says.
I know the VG Gaming guys. Like, we had this Meow one from Ice Ice Ice. Yeah. So it's the golden tide for him. What else do we have? Who can even translate that? Right, what the hell? That's the Shadow Demon, right?
What? No, that's...
That's Shadow Demon.
Oh, wait. What are you talking about?
This is Shadow Demon.
Oh, is it?
He's just bent over like he's breathing. Like heavy breathing.
I don't know maybe if that's what that he's says. Doing.
All this says is heavy breathing.
Okay. I don't know if heavy breathing is what he's going for there, but... So Vici Gaming right now, they're doing what they should. They're invading their own jungle, and you might actually see an engagement here is... Empire is doing the same, and I think part of the reason as well they decided to take the Sven over something greedier is because you want a hero that can contest into the jungle, and Sven has that multiple hero stun.
Here they come. So I'm really distracted by Crystal Maiden looking at her toes. So off we go, Team Empire. I like a VG. Let's just kick off this game with a full-on fight. Aloha Dance the first one up. And, well, Yoki was the back, so he's not gonna get the stun, but there is the glimpse back. FY's the first one back with the Stormbolt. Only connects on the Vengeful Spirit. Now the double Burrow Strike. They get the first battle. Low Ardent actually being denied by this man in the middle of the fight.
No.
He actually doesn't even get the kill for it. And they're chasing deeper for Ice Ice. Ice got three poison stacks. It's not enough to get the kill. They'll lose the Shadow Demon. So that's the first real kill coming the way of VG Gaming. His house backing up. And Yoki in range of the tower, trying to Burrow Strike away. Not gonna happen now. It's VG Gaming, technically 2-for-1 is their advantage. Super right behind him. The Shadow Strike slowing down Silent Resolution. There's nothing he can do. He's got mana for the Axis. He's looking for the pickoff and Ice Ice Ice. He won't be able to find it. And now Resolution running away. The trees couldn't get in front of him. There's mana for a Lance in maybe 8 seconds up against Resolution. Yoki will take the rune and can turn around for a Burrow Strike. The trees now body blocking him up. It's Ice 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 with the micro. How's going to drop down? There's those Axis from Resolution. Find the kill. Yoki still being body blocked up by the Treants. And they got enough damage. That's the Treants that do the last points of damage to get the kill, and we'll have 6 deaths in the first 20 official seconds of this game.
Yeah, and right there, Empire, they just didn't have enough damage. They hard commit so far past the tower, and I mean, that was just beautiful play by Ice 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 and Hal stretching their heroes to the limits as Ice 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 able to survive there, picking up a kill, getting 2 assists on top of that, and that's going to be massive here for him in the offlane as things have started out really clowny and nobody's really established the lanes because of that type of action. And these are 2 teams that aren't willing to back down off of each other.
Mm-hmm. Should also flag too that the 2 runes which got picked up, one was by the SK and one was by this event. So both runes still went the way of Empire as well. It's not going to balance the loss at the start. Well, then again, I say that. I still bring up the gold graph and it was 100%
it's
on 0. So yeah, for all of that, it's even trade.
Yeah, so getting the 2 bounty runes obviously helps, but if you're looking at the scoreboard, I think there is a concept to be said about momentum and just how you kind of feel about things. If you're Vici Gaming, I think you're finally satisfied with how the early game has went. You're thinking to yourself, wow, we came out on top in terms of kills. We gave up the first blood, yes, but it's still 2-4, and Ice 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 has finally had a really good start.
Yeah, he's found levels. And as Nate just brought up, he's going to feel so comfortable with this too. The ability to TP out while still being able to summon a whole bunch of treants and be very, very annoying up against the SD. It might also be a little bit more comforting for the fact that he knows that it's going to take a while for SD to hit both disruption as well as catch up, because he went for the poison at the very, very start. With the very choked up teamfight position, it was very understandable that he would do that. I also want to watch just how effective Yoki's going to be on this top lane. Like with this SK... How much is the Sandstorm really going to do? And is there any way to really stop him? Because is there detection? Probably a bigger question, there's actually no detection. So he can sit inside the Sandstorm and not be brought out of it.
Yeah, and Fenrir top, because they weren't able to really ward up the jungle too heavily, he's been having a good time. He's already picked up his level 3 2 minutes in. He's going to come in here, take the large creep. Thought it was stacked for a second. It's not. Wanted to be able to take it out, and at bottom, Silent dives pretty heavily for Ice 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 to try to zone him out of the lane.
He's gonna war cry and run himself away. But the tree is just body blocking him up the entire time. And it really is like, I'm just happy we get a nice Ice Nature's Prophet. I'm interested to see too his build, because this is one of these things with the new Nature's Prophet. I say the new Nature's Prophet with the new items to make the new Nature's Prophet. The fact that you can have something like the Silver Edge gives the Shadow Blade more of a reason to be picked up again on Nature's Prophet, as opposed to like this Blink Maelstrom build, which was like the older reincarnation of the Nature's Prophet. And then on top of that, the Aghanims. There's not many players in the world that can micro up an Aghanims creating Treant Prophet. But Ice would be the one to do it.
Yeah, I think the main reason he wouldn't go for that, though, is because Super and the Phantom Lancer need to be able to farm safely. And yep. If he goes for that Aghanim Scepter, they've kind of maybe conceded at that point that they're losing the game, and he has to get, like, yep. 8 slotted.
It'll be a late-game luxury item. He needs control items for now.
Yeah, exactly. And you have to wait anyways for Super to be able to get some farm before you hard commit to something like that. And in this mid lane, Super's doing just fine for himself. With the help of the kill in the very beginning, I think that the advantage that he's taken is quite significant.
He's actually keeping Beastmaster completely out of the lane. Like, it's 7-1. Beastmaster still found levels, but Super's a level and a half in front of him. And double the CS. Actually, more than double the CS, because he also got 12 denies for that mid lane.
It's honestly just from the beginning where Super didn't have to expend so much. He got the dagger level 1 was resolution. Had to expend dagger or mana after mana trying to get kills. And so I think that Super ends up the beneficiary of that. And at bottom as well, Ice is getting quite a lot. Level 4 already, and top seems to have been abandoned right now by Yoki.
Always when a fly is going to come up and take it instead. It's allowing Yoki to take up the stacks which prepared for him inside the jungle. So they're looking for the timing and the blink dagger here for Team Empire. At the same time, Resolution's down to level 5. He's not level 6 yet. In fact, Super's dropping him down quite low. I'm waiting for this blink to Sonic Wave just to finish him off. But it's the fact that you can have both Roar as well as that blink to Burrow Strike and Zven getting bigger and bigger. Because Silent is the top CSer on the board, more than the PL at the moment.
And always want to fly at top. He is being dived.
Defensive Disruption should be able to save him, and Yoki will TP in. VG Gaming are very, very deep here.
Playing really aggressive, want to take down the tower as quick as they can. The main reason they're doing this as well, Toby, is because it allows an infusion of gold, and it allows the Chen to kind of do that early so he can go and open up the map for himself. It kind of secures the jungle so nobody can TP on that top area. It makes it a little bit safer, and it just buys him time to be able to do whatever he wants.
Kind of watching this bottom lane too. Ice. Oh, God, Sprout. Actually, it means so if Silent cuts through with the Culling Blade, he still has to walk around. The Shadow Strike's going to be there. The Glimpse, there's no TPing away from this. Or actually, maybe there is. That's going to be it. And that's going to be a very quick disruptor kill as well as Van Death.
Yeah, so 2 kills off the bat at bottom. A huge rotation by Vici Gaming, but absolutely well worth it. And finally, I mean, Vici, this is the style they want to play. Absolutely punish. Rotate Super as much as you can. Get him snowballing off the bat, and he's had such a good laning phase, and that's something that we haven't seen from him. Most of the time, I feel like Resolution has been taking a bit of the better of the lanes, but I think in this one, it's definitely Super's game.
Yeah, the Super's going to be careful not to lose this. Yoki's waiting for some kind of, like, gap to have a crack at him, but they blink away. Aloha Dance moves in, but the Glimpse is on cooldown now. Can't find an opening.
Yeah, Resolution was 6 there. I think they would have gone for it, but unable to do so, and Yoki, though, he does get his level 6 now. So it's a level 3 Sun and a level 3 Sandstorm.
Someone's got to do something about this PL. How's just... This PL could be completely out of control if this Ven can't get himself a BKB and extra damage output.
Yeah, but Silent has been able to keep up in farm so far. Really impressive considering the type of pressure he's seen from Ice. As he's topping the leaderboard in terms of CS right now, but the Chen, surprisingly, and the Phantom Lancer right behind him. And this Chen has had such a good time so far this game, Toby.
Yeah, because the jungle wasn't controlled at all. You're spending most of your time trying to fight. You're thinking, well, I'll leave some wards behind so Chen can't have any camps. He's had the entire jungle to do whatever the hell he wants.
Yeah, and he picks up his level 6. He's farming, about to pick up his level 6, and he's farming both camps at once right now, using his creeps. And that's going to be so huge because a lot of what Empire does is rely on the burst damage. And once that gets taken away from them with the Hand of God, then things get a bit tricky for them.
Notice too the fact that Zven hasn't gone for the Gold Strength. Instead, he's gone for the 3-3-1 build. So it's not looking for fights, it's just looking to deal with all of these Treants and keep that bottom lane pushed. I'm wondering if that's also because he's worried about Ice TPing out to try and find kills. And if that happens, he just wants the ability to just push the lane as quickly as possible.
Oh, and they found Always Want to Fly right now.
That Lance is slowing down, though. Defensive Disruptor is going to stop it from happening. And there's more support rotating in. The Disruptor is on the way in. Aloha Dance can't do anywhere near enough damage to change anything. And Resolution also walking in. This 10 army, the Sonic Wave from Super and Empire, really are going to regret taking this fight. Even at the Wrath of Nature popping through. Three players down. Fenrir is the lowest one. He's got Hand of God available. Got to trigger it right now to keep himself alive if he wants to live through this. In fact, he just nukes down Yoki instead. And they're going to take a 4-for-1 trade-off. I don't know if the Chen really had to die there, but either way, VG Gaming, insanely solid start to this game.
Yeah, and it's honestly just the off the top of that top fight. Even if things went 0-for-0 in terms of gold, it was 2-for-4. The bigger issue there is that they didn't get any real damaging wards into the jungle. And Fenrir, I mean, we've seen him pressured every single time he's played a jungler, but this time he's finally been able to create space for himself. He's got a lot of creeps that haven't been contested, and you can't fight into the Chen creeps this early on. Like, it's just impossible right now.
This is exactly as you're predicting. If the Chen has a good start, if he actually is active on the map, then VG Gaming just roll with the momentum. And it's going to get worse for Empire. When this Hand of Midas arrives for the Nature's Prophet, he can transition into any item he wants to. The fact that PL has already, well, practically got to a point of having drums, he just needs the recipe for it. He can go into anything he wants to, too. And what's Yoki really done? Like, you pick up the early Sol Ring, he didn't go for the very raw kind of build of having the Blink Dagger off the cuff. It's not going to be long before he's got it, but Team Empire really need to do something with this when it comes up.
Yeah, and I just like the moves that VG have been able to make this game. Like, look how aggressively they entered the jungle. They were fully committed to a 5-man at, like, 10 minutes into the... even before 10 minutes into the game. It's like an 8-minute rotation where they bring their entire lineup, pretty much, to invade the enemy team jungle to slow down whatever stacks are going down, maybe contest the Sven. Like, this is the kind of VG Gaming that you want to see playing, where they kind of keep their opponents off kilter, not really being able to decipher what's going on, and how atop.
Yeah, they're really going to see if they can find this kill. They need the vision, so the Hawk comes in, and that'll allow for the roar. Aloha Dance doesn't have an ultimate, however, so Hal will still be at a doppelganger. And where's he going? He goes down into the river, but they keep the vision. Bring him back up again and Burrow Strike. And this is the strength of Empire. What they've shown throughout this entire tournament is the rotation timings and the abilities to catch out other heroes, and they're doing it perfectly. Now, Always Want to Fly, Defensive Disruption, he knows he's dead. There's no surviving this at all.
Yeah. No chance of being able to deny himself with the illusions, which I think is what he was going for at the same time, but unable to do so. Yoki's about to pick up his Blink Dagger as well, and once that kind of happens, now you've sort of hit a timing where you can start to get dangerous on the map because he has his ultimate, but for that to happen, you need Aloha Dance on level 6 right now.
Yeah, which you just don't have. And they can't give him the space up on top. Space on bottom's about to become very, very restricted. Silent about to get ganked up. He has enough money for his Morbid Mask, Mask of Madness, sorry. But these Treants, he can see him coming in and realizes there's trouble. TP down, Hal doppelgangering in and Silent, trying to hold in the tree line, and now in comes that SK. Into the trees, he can start the Epicenter, Blink Burrow Strikes, actually controlling Super, the VS will swap him out, and there's that Hand of God to keep him alive. Yoki hiding inside the Sandstorm. The Centaur Stomp was actually off target, but they're gonna kill him off anyway with the screams and the extra nukage they've got. And that'll be the tier 1 tower in the bottom lane to also drop with him. VG Gaming keeping that momentum up.
And once again, this is the strength of the Chen. Getting into early fights like this, it's just impossible right now. And Empire, they're trying to rotate heroes down, but it's simply not enough. And this game, the supports just feel like they've been phased out. Always Want to Fly, level 3. Aloha Dance, level 5. Not a lot of impact that you felt from this. And it all comes down to the decision by VG Gaming to protect their own jungle and go for the outplays. Like, there was so much banking on that. Like, imagine if Ice and Hao die there, and they're able to get the wards down. I feel like this game is almost instantly over. Yep. But because they weren't able to do that, they didn't invade the jungle for once. It just set the tone up so well for Fenrir to be able to snowball on this Chen.
They took the risk, and it worked out perfectly. And this is almost where, like, the Empire supports, you say, like, they're being crippled. Where do they even go from here? It's not like you've got that old classic, well, I'm going to have like a Mirana into a, like, for a Bane Nightmare kind of combination, or the SD disruption into that kind of arrow kind of thing, or with a Latrak Split Earth. They don't have these kind of combos. They've got some chase, but they still require the Sven the Beastmaster as well as the SK to do most damage. Now in comes your Epicenter, right inside of Roshan. How? He's going to go down. FY's in the tree line. How? Actually, no, he stays alive. He doppelganged it up onto the high ground. Roshan's still not dead yet. The Disruptor has the ulti. And who's got the Aegis?
Killed by the Queen of Pain.
Killed up by the Queen of Pain. She'll come back to life again. But for how long is the question? Burrow Strike in, and Super's on the sideline. They know How's on the high ground, but where's the stun? They actually stop it. They actually cancel the TP out. They pick up the PL. And what was a beautiful, beautiful picture for the game number two is now a horrible, horrible image.
What the hell just happened? They were going to get the Roshan. They even get the last hit off on it, but Yoki with the clutch ultimate comes in, just does terrible amounts of damage, and then all of a sudden things just go terrible for Vici Gaming. I mean, that was a level 3 Shadow Demon that was participating in a fight and a level 5 Disruptor, Toby. Like, put that in your mind. It's a level 3 and a level 5 support, respectively. They both gained 2 levels off of that fight.
Dude.
I don't understand how Empire makes that call and goes for that. I think they realize, like, okay, if we give up the Aegis, the game's essentially over. Like, they're just going to snowball. The Queen of Pain will be unkillable. But, man, the teamfight execution, they realize that's their best shot. Even if they don't have the levels, the Sand King ultimate play for that. And Yoki just comes up huge.
They couldn't have asked for something better. They just repaired about 5,000 gold and experience difference. I say about, it's a little bit closer towards 4K. But still, they're back into this game. The SK is the highest net worth on the field, would you believe? Go Yoki. But the Beastmaster is catching up. He's now actually, with that, he gets a level 2 Necro Book up for resolution. These fights are going to be so different.
Oh, and at top, Ice. He gets caught out as well. And things are just starting to fall apart for the Vici squad.
It's not enough damage. The Thunderstrike's not enough damage to kill him off, so he'll survive. And they'll TP out.
Yeah, Hand of God used up there. But still, Empire getting aggressive across the map right now. And FY knows he's here. Yoki just going to try to get out.
What's he going to do against him? He drops the sentry ward. Now Yoki's just forced him to use a sentry ward and TP's away to safety. Because they have to. They don't have dust, or even if they expel dust, you're still revealing a sandstormed SK.
Yeah. So this Queen of Pain, still at the top of the leaderboard, and just behind them is this Vendo, who has been farming this entire time. Resolution also manages to make himself into third, and Sand King just behind the Phantom Lantern, so the net worths are starting to even out. The dangerous thing for Empire, though, is that their supports, they need them to have some amount of farm.
Yoki, the Burrow Strike, into a disruption from Always Wanna Fly, allows them to blink away to safety. They planted a secondary sentry ward to make that happen, swap into stun, but Yoki's just too quick on the Burrow.
Yeah, and they know that they're in the jungle, right, or in the ancient area, into the secret shop, and it looks like they're making their way mid. They do have Centaur set up here, and Ice is kind of low, but he is...
He's being sent back by Fenrir.
He's fine, He's a Nature's Prophet. He'll get back here in time. And
it was calculated.
Yeah, they're making an aggressive move on mid, but they have to be careful as Yoki has his ultimate, and this is a pretty heavy commitment right now for Vici Gaming.
Do they have any vision up here?
They can't get caught out by this again.
They actually don't see him up there. They have no idea. So disruption. Yoki's still not prepping this Epicenter, and now just Burrow Strikes an instant Sandstorm. The swap out, but FY sacrificing himself raw, keeps him in range of the Static Storm. Still not dead yet. The one charges keep him alive, not to mention the Strength Tread switch, but he's still going to potentially, yeah, he does die. That's the SD, that's fine. Disruptor will also drop though, so VG Gaming looking for some openings until the Epicenter will connect. It's a good Sonic Wave with a Centaur Stump, but he's gone down too super. Back in the fight, the Lance will kill off Yoki as Resolution right behind
Yao. One more hit on
no
super!
No matter do anything else. So he's going to actually die on this top lane too, so as Ven kills off the Queen of Pain and Resolution right behind him. What actually happened to super?
He actually just got chased down by Silent, who has his ultimate popped with the Mask of Madness, and I mean, the damage that he's putting out is unreal, and once again, Vici Gaming, they had such a dominant start, 7,500 gold at, what was it, 12 minutes into this game, and all of a sudden, another 5-man team wipe as the gold starts to creep closer and closer to zero, Toby.
It's crazy. I can't believe Empire is really doing this. It looked like it was just going to be a quick game from VG. We're like, hey, VG are back again. But there's one thing we should still flag. It's the fact that Empire, as well as VG, it's not as though like anyone's playing badly. It's the fact they're just playing better than the other team. And Empire, the rotation's up, even the first kill on the PL, like that was the start of it. And then Yoki kicks in. Initially, we're saying, you know, Aloha Dance is the man of the moment. His Disruptor has just won Empire so many of these engagements. But this game, it really feels like Yogi's been the big man in the fight. Obviously, the Roshan moment for him is just so epic. But then Silent is able to find space from this. And then Resolution now has a level 3 Necro book, 17 minutes in. He's 5-1-5 on this Beastmaster after being shut down the CS by Super.
Yeah, and if it sounds like we're being biased towards Empire, don't get us wrong. Yep. Everybody understands that Vici is considered one of the best teams, if not the best team in the world. And it's just the simple fact of how Empire are coming back into these games that are so exciting. And so Vici Gaming, I mean, they still have what it takes to win this game, as the Queen of Pain is still really farmed. You still have Ice,
yeah,
who's playing a hero that he can absolutely snowball in. I feel like with the clockwork, there are so few chances of him getting back into this game. But Nature's Prophet with the Hand of Midas, this is like an iconic combination. He can still get farm, he can still put split push, and as long as Vici kind of slow things down and don't get into these commitments, because it seems like they keep forgetting about the Sand King ultimate. Like, it's been two fights in a row where it's just dominated them.
Yeah. And they grouped up, and also Yoki mixing up the time for it too. Like, the first one, you initiated with the Epicenter. You went into Roshan, you threw out the Epi, and that's where you want all your damage to come. The second time he did it, he Burrow Strikes in, stuns up two heroes, then throws out the Sandstorm, and waits for a time when he can then finish off the heroes with the Epicenter, ensuring the kills more than anything else. And in doing what he had to do, which was get the earlier control.
Here's what we're seeing from Vici Gaming. As a bottom lane, they are pushing this out, and this is what we were talking about. If the supports are under level, they're not able to get items like Glimmer Capes. It's going to be hard for them to be able to force Ice out of this bottom lane, as he just kind of starts flitting around the map, going from his base to the bottom lane, opening up the jungle as well for them. As Vici Gaming realize they can't just get into five-man engagements like they were before.
Yeah, they just waited out. The key for Vici is, maybe you'll agree or disagree with me on this one, but if they can stall it up and make sure they've still got control over
the top.
Yeah, they have a crack at Resolution with the Orchid, as well as the Sonic Wave and Shadow Strike. He wants to TP himself out. The Sprout will give him the vision.
Oh, he actually gets the kill on Super, though.
Wait, did he kill the Necro unit?
Oh, my. Oh, no. And that's actually just a straight-up trade for him, and they're perfectly okay, because that's a three-man commitment right now for Vici Gaming, and what could have been a push kind of gets stopped without the help of Super.
He was in also range of the XP, because the kill happened beforehand. So Vengeful Spirit took all the experience, because Queen of Pain died first. So you actually still got 1,200 experience points into the Beastmaster.
Yeah, and
Beastmaster
Silent
for that.
At bottom, takes this tower down, no problem, and all of a sudden you've got a level 15 Silent who's got the highest net worth in the game. And consecutive deaths right now for the Queen of Pain make this difficult for Vici to contest in a straight-up engagement. But at the same time, I mean,
Ice. Aloha Dance with the ulti, locks him in the wall, and for the Storm Bolt, Masked Man is on cooldown. Ice trying to run to the pit, but he won't survive. The Disruptor will take the kill. And the downside about Nature's Prophet, who is going for a Necro book when you're up against something like a Glimpse, you got no way to dispel it.
Yeah, good pick off right then. They absolutely needed to kill Ice. They can't let him snowball. I feel like if Vici Gaming are going to win this game, it's on the back of Ice being able to split out the map, creating time for Hao. But every single time he dies there, it just kind of shortens the window on what they have to do as Empire gets stronger and stronger. And I mean, Vici Gaming, they don't have the best way to deal with Silent.
I don't think they've got any way to deal with him. Like, you're talking about Nate's Prophet making space. He's also going to be the Disabler. He needs a Scythe of Vice. He needs a way to be able to control this Ven before he gets the BKB off, which means you almost need Blink and Scythe of Vice. The Necro units won't be enough. So Ven will just pop BKB, come in, cleave them up, and then there's nothing more to be done.
Yeah, and Hao continues to farm up. And what impresses me most about Hao's Phantom Lancer is just the fact that no matter what is happening on the map, he always knows where to be. Like, in terms of going aggressive, participating in fights with his team, and just creating space for himself, it feels. Like, he is really independent. He doesn't really care what the rest of his team is doing. He's just kind of trying to get farm, be the stable core that Vici Gaming need. And I think he's really kind of changed up his playstyle for this game especially. You're not seeing, like, the super aggressive Hao, which kind of runs in and tries to make stuff happen. He's just trying to farm and keep his team in this in terms of net worth.
Mm-hmm. That's the way to do it for now. How long we got till our next Roshan? So he's actually a pretty long spawn timer. You got Nature's Prophet Treant just sitting inside there keeping tabs on it. So we got 1 minute. So at the 23 minute mark, we look for Roshan attempts. And already they're coming to scout it out. They got to keep the Hawks away, Vici Gaming.
Oh, they're going to actually run into each other here as Yoki finds them both.
Got a double burrow strike too, but he doesn't want to fight this. There's no way he wants to fight this. Blinks away, the lance will disjoint, but a low art dance being defusal bladed up, so he's going to drop before he gets amping off. At the same time, Nature's Prophet was still brought down. The Hand of God from Fanrir, it's a little bit too late to save his teammate. As we've got Necros on Necros.
Yeah,
it's actually Chen stealing. Yep.
Fichi Gaming with an inefficient trade, losing your Nature's Prophet for the Disruptor, but...
Maybe it's not that bad, though, because you're still pushing in through the bottom lane.
Yeah,
you still
exactly.
Got momentum with how he's got this fresh Diffusal Blade, and your Chen Army. They want to take out buildings. They want to take out towers. When Prophet comes back, he can just go towards the top lane and keep the split push going. The VG need to make sure that Empire feel like their buildings are always in peril.
Exactly, and that's the thing, is that even though Empire are winning a lot of these engagements, they're unable to really get any sort of momentum off of this. Like, they'll get a kill on the Nature's Prophet, but it's so deep into their jungle that they can't capitalize or get momentum going. And I think that's the important thing, is that even if Ice dies, it depends on where he dies. If it's not in his own jungle, if he's all the way deep into your base, I think it's perfectly okay for him at this point to take risks like that.
And then the status of the lanes as well. Like, you kill him off on that far side of your jungle, then... What, Wrath of Nature's already been cast before it, so your creep waves are pushing out. The Chen army could already be adding some level of momentum towards the waves. It doesn't take long for VG Gaming to give a burst momentum to the waves, because Super can just come in, scream it, and then his creep waves, you basically go to it at pretty much full life, and that in itself creates a large amount of momentum for VG.
Exactly, and so how TP's in this mid lane, it's been a while since he's died, picks up another kill on the Disruptor as
TP.
Well.
We've got BT's up for resolution. He goes on Ice. Necros on Necros. But Ice, he's got a TP scroll, but it's not quick enough. Resolution sets himself up and then finishes the job. And with this kill, VG Gaming, they've only got four players up in the vision for the Radiant side. Yeah, Yoki.
Oh, Epi Yoki.
Center, we're going again. Burrow Strike on four with the Epicenter. She only got the three. Fenrir was not held on in place by this one, but he'll set the route away from the stun. And in comes Silent. Fenrir trapped inside the pit, and Silent knows it. But then again, the Glimmer Cape is allowing Fenrir to stay alive, but they've got this swap going on. The Disruptor, there it is again from Yoki. Another double Burrow Strike in with the Sandstorm. It's huge amounts of damage. How so low?
Oh, how's actually gone
24
now?
HP. He's alive. The catcher can't get close enough. Sonic Wave down now. Yoki's on the run out of here. Yule Scepter up. Supra's now low as well. Yoki in with the Burrow Strike. Three heroes down. Hal is still running far west. But what's he going to do? He can't TP out. He's too low to cross the lines of Empire.
Yeah, and he doesn't really know where the wards are right now, so he's really afraid. I can't believe he survived that. And oh, he actually just dodges that out. And if he runs into Aloha Dance right now, oh, and he's actually...
How do you get out of here?
He's actually so scared right now because he doesn't understand what's going on. Oh, Yoki actually goes the other way, and Hao is kind of stuck in this jungle. He's trying to make a beeline across. He's going to run into this creep wave, but he should be fine with nobody near him. But again...
He's coming for a TP scroll.
Yeah, Yoki with that ultimate, they have to respect it more.
Man, it would have been just the icing on the cake if Yoki was able to get the kill on Hao without actually intending to do it, because he just went in there to Sandstorm Farm. That was it.
Silent right now is just too difficult to deal with. Critting for 700 even without his ultimate up, and that's not even counting the Mask of Madness, Toby. And
it's rough. To put it lightly for VG Gaming, after such an advantage, you look at the graph, they had 7.5k net worth advantage. It's changed 10,000 net worth change in the space of what is that, 13 minutes in half the time of this game. And the experience, that's what we call a drastic change in the experience graph, all the way up from 7k to roughly 7.5k.
Yeah, and if Hao actually died there, I feel like Empire just break the back of VG Gaming. I don't know how Vici's gonna feel about that. You know, they're gonna be really disheartened. They're like, we actually just lost everyone once again. Mm-hmm. But Hao surviving there, I think it's gonna kind of provide them a morale boost. They're going to say, okay, our carry survived at the very least. So worst comes to worst, that happened.
The TPing him. It's Beastmaster with a Blink Dagger over on Resolution. He just goes for the Roar on FY and the Necro units. He's got no mana to do anything while the ultimate and Burrow Strike, they've found Hal. The Epicenter's going to be committed as well because they did more damage in the time and Hal's going to drop. And well, that momentum you were talking about, moral spirit to keep Hal alive.
It was there, so... Fenrir is actually going to be chased out as well, as Yoki soon has a Blink Strike. I think he's just going to Yule's him. And
yep.
Yeah, they've got this.
Sandstorm, Storm Bolt, and then just Disruptor kill secure.
Oh, that's going to be a gem as well if they notice that. And Yoki actually
Wait,
doesn't.
They don't. Courier. Kuria, do it. You know it. Oh, you know you can. The VG Gaming. Yoki, he's jumping Yoki. Over. He actually passed the gem. The pin came out, but now the Kuria. Get away with it. Get away with it. Run, Kuria. It survives.
That's a small boon for VG Gaming, because I feel like if they lose the gem at that point, it's so huge. But at top, I mean, Silent's just marching in. He's got his God Strength popped as well. The damage is real. Doing so much damage, and Ice 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 might be caught out. No, gets Orchided.
Aloha Dance wasn't sure about. Now the body block with the trees, but Super Stunlock. Oh my lord! He got caught. He got carved up. They have a double buyback with both the PL. Aloha Dance will go down. Hound's just looking for revenge. Silent also too far up, but that's the Aegis Immortal triggered for him. Does he still have? He's still got the BKB. If he can get it off in time, in fact, is he waiting for Magic Missile? No, he just triggers it anyway. Runs out of here. Yoki's out of mana, and Silent, he's just going to turn and fight. And Fenrir, two swings, can't do the job. Glimmer Cape forcing him to change out targets. Now VG Gaming, they're getting on top of the fight. Silent's getting carved up a new one. It does still cost him very, very heavily. They also lost the courier in the middle of all of this.
Yeah, and this is exactly what VG Gaming needed to get back into this game, because Empire had a firm hold on this and it looked like Rax were going to be taken top, but a couple of buybacks and better fighting just enables them to win that fight, even with the Aegis up. I mean, that is kind of the weakness of Sven. You need your team behind you to be able to output the damage, because even if he has overwhelming farm, once his BKB's done, you kind of just get kited around, and we saw that with the Chen getting Glimmer Caped up. And good fight for VG Gaming as they avoid losing Rax and at the same time able to take down Silent.
Interesting to see that Lohan Dance TP's up towards the top lane. He's just picked up a Blink Dagger, so he's able to reposition himself as this Disruptor. But using that TP means he can't come into the mid. You've already got that Orchid from Super going and always want to fly with a Sonic Wave. FY, there's that Disruptor ultimate. It holds Super in position, but FY's still hanging around. He wants to kill and always want to fly. He's going to find it too. The Roar controlling FY and then the Sandbags. FY won't be saved. But meanwhile, up on the north, how as well as Ice Ice Ice? They push down. In fact, they were the ones to kill off this Sven. They just Prophet was the one to find the kill, so Ice 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 getting some good cash into him and damage into the tier 2 tower, more importantly. But the TPs are coming in. The Wrath of Nature hits a Aloha Dance, so he can't just blink himself up and chase after Hal.
Oh, he's actually going to go for it right now, though.
They're going to glimpse him in. Aloha Dance. They've got a little bit of trouble, but there's a good Storm Bolt. Hal's going to drop. He's locked inside the wall, and they Barrow Strike to keep the PL illusions out. The tower is still killed off by the Dire side, but it's a worthwhile kill for Team Empire to bring down Hal.
Yeah, absolutely. Being able to get that kill opens up things again for you. As Silent picks up the kill on that, it only takes about 5 swings for him to do it. And once he gets the Assault Curse as well, I think that's going to mean Empire just going for the Death Ball push. But VG Gaming have to avoid that for as long as possible. And this, a lot of it comes down on Ice Ice Ice. He's got to keep the map split open as possible. Push out the bottom lane. Don't let the creep stack up. But I don't even know if he's going to be able to do that with Silent just being able to go one-man army style.
Ice 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 needs to get a blink or something. Something to get himself away from him, but he's got 3,000 gold. So a surplus of 2 points, almost enough for the blink dagger with the surplus. The top racks being attacked, fortification still on cooldown for the moment. Only 3 more seconds left. It's a ranged racks. VG Gaming won't want to commit anything to really defend this. Okay, maybe they will. They actually use the fortification to try and keep it alive. Ice 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 needs 8 seconds until these Necro units are available. There's no Hand of God. Blink Burrow. Super's the first man to be called out. VS swaps him back and Super sent all the way back to base. So FY is going to drop here. And they actually glimpse him all the way back in again. He waited perfectly and Super didn't trigger the BKB at the start. So he took a large amount of damage. The Sprout comes in and the Necro units are battling. They're going to find always want to fly. But it's the consolation prize right now for VG Gaming. They didn't want the support. The kinetic field holds them out. And the rest of Empire will disengage.
Yeah, and Silent has to get out of here. He does have the Calling Blade. Eating his way through right now is Aloha. VG Gaming.
They turn. Yoki, Epicenter up. It's not enough damage on Hal and FY to get the kill. The Axe are coming in to try and help him out, but with the Necro units down, they can see Yoki. A Yule Scepter up. He needs time for the Blink Dagger, but does not have it, and out of mana for a Burrow Strike. The wall is up, but he still will not be surviving this.
And meanwhile, though, Silent did take out Super by himself, and that Queen of Pain, you know, she started with the highest net worth in the game, but starts to plummet after death after death, and on top of that, the buybacks as well, and Silent being able to get that kill is so huge, because you weren't meant to get anything out of that. Oh, it's the refresher.
Cool. But
yeah. What's your question?
I'm good?
It's what?
Yeah, okay, never mind.
It's 2 Perseverances now.
Yeah, I know, I'm just like, I had a double check, and I'm like, why the hell do we have 2 Perseverances? Like, oh, wait, no, it got changed.
Toby.
keeping up, man.
I'm like the worst at mechanics, and even I knew that one.
That's not mechanics. That's an item build, and it changes. Don't try and teach an old dog new tricks.
Yeah, so I think that getting the refresh orb, being able to lock out two heroes from Vici Gaming is absolutely huge. And, man, Vici, though, able to hold on time and time again. It feels like they're about to break, but they managed to hold on the back of this Howl Phantom Lancer, who...
Resolution's about to get double kill.
Damage.
He comes up. Hi, Fenrir. Necro unit summon. And Fenrir's gone. Can't keep anything up. The TP's coming in from Nature's Prophets. They might try and battle up against Resolution.
Oh, he gets a
but
blink.
He actually blinked away. He actually got himself out of that mess. The Necro units will die here. In fact, they're still mopping up the mana.
All right, Resolution's actually just playing with them now. He's so good.
Oops. Aloha Dance
he's
is in trouble.
He's just got two gems right now.
Super's got this kill. He'll commit the Sonic Wave to kill off Aloha Dance.
Did you forget your You're okay with that right now, though, if you're Empire, because you do manage to be able to kill the Chen at the same time, and not losing Resolution at the same time is pretty key, and he's got his Refresher Orb right now, and I don't know if Empire has to wait for any more items. Maybe they wait for the Roshan at worst. That's the timing they hit, but I think they have the Assault Curse ready to go on the Sven. He's got enough charges of BKB still. Like, 7 charges is perfectly fine. I feel like he should get a Blink Dagger instead of the Calling Blade at some point, mm-hmm. but in terms of anything else, I don't really feel like he needs more damage.
I don't know if he even needs that. Just get more life, more sustainability up against VG. I am a little bit worried about the mana pool of Resolution. To let off two Roars plus the Refresher and using your Necro units. I know it's only 50 mana for that, and if you use Axes on top of that, correct me if I'm wrong, but he doesn't have a mana pool that can support that. And he's got no regeneration really kicking in as well. Like, not burst regen like having Arcane Boots or something.
Yeah, the problem right now for Vici Gaming, though, is that Super hasn't seen any sort of item progression in quite some time, and they need him to, because he's part of the reason why they've been able to keep in this game, but, you know, time after time, if fights just go south and he's the first one to die, it doesn't really add anything for their net worth, and so Silence absolutely huge. Got 2,800 gold to back himself up, and Vici Gaming just trying to extend the game for as long as possible.
He doesn't even stick around for the kill. He just gets away, leaves the Necro units behind, kills up the Vengeful Spirit. Now that's 70 seconds on the sideline because he bought back during the previous fight.
What are you supposed to do, though? It's like an aerial attack.
You can't do jack. Like, you actually cannot do anything. And now in mid, the wall is up as well as the Static Storm, and they're controlling Fenrir, trying to take out these two supports. Fenrir's going to survive through all of this, and they just get out.
They're just trying to buy time right now for the Roshan.
Yep. It's all smoke and mirrors. It's all distraction. So now Empire, like, who's going to take this Aegis the Immortal? It goes into the hands of Resolution. Yoki will take the cheese just to go along with the casual Aghanim Scepter and Veil of Discord he's managed to pick up 35 minutes into the game.
And I think this is the right choice because Silent doesn't want to drop his Mask of Madness. It increases his damage output by quite a lot, and he needs the Blink Dagger to be able to get on top of people. And so, good decision, I feel, giving it to Resolution. He has so much net worth built up on him. I think he has quite a big spree as well, so being able to save him with that would be huge. And
It's still going to be difficult for Empire to finish this. There's 3 buybacks on 2 of the cores here of VG Gaming, Profit as well as PL. So holding this high ground is possible. You've still got the million ranks on the top. It just will probably be very costly.
Yeah, but Ice manages to pick up a Scythe of Ice right now, and I think they absolutely need this item to be able to lock down the Sven pre-BKB or even after BKB, because fighting Silent head-on is going to be kind of impossible. Like, they just have to kite him for as long as they can.
Yep. Man, I almost feel like they got to use that over on... what do you want to do? You want to try and control the Beastmaster as well? The only thing you can hope is the fact that Hal can burn out all of his mana at the start of the fight. And now Hal's even being turned against himself as SD. It's the old count of the PL where you just disrupt one of the illusions and then you just make Hal fight Hal.
So... at bottom, Empire is pushing in right now. I think this is going to mean they're going to go for broke here with this push. There's enough for Silent to buy back as well as Resolution.
Yep.
They've got the Aegis and the cheese. There's no reason not to go for it right now. And even if your team fight is sloppy, there's not too much to lose here, as Silent just has so much of a net worth lead on everybody in the game.
And when Resolution buys back, he just BTs directly into the fight too. So you've got him multiple times over straight away.
Yeah, exactly. And Empire are going to circle out, just kind of gauge the distance, wait to pick their spots, and at top they don't have to do anything right now. They just have to kind of wait it out, send things at the tower. Play the positional game if you're Empire.
Oh, here they come. Howl's in pretty close. Tried to actually kill off the Hawk. And FY, they're in very, very close. Resolution.
Oh,
and that is a big ulti, but Silent's very, very low. He can't kill off him, but then all of a sudden, the epicenter will arrive. And life was great. Now Resolution and secondary Raw. He finds Howl. Silent, it looked a little bit risky for him, but now he's going to be successful. Yoki Burrow strikes up, takes out the Chen. Super as well as Ice will find him, but then again, Yule Scepter delaying the timeout. No Burrow Strike, but he's still got Cheese available. Defensive Disruption buys them time. Resolution running out of mana, but the Burrow Strike in again from Yoki with the Sandstorm. Hound's got nowhere to go. They're locked inside the kinetic field. This could be it. The Agassi model has already popped, but that's the only thing that's really been lost. Super's gonna lose his life. Silent blinks himself up, looking for the last hit. There goes Super.
Oh,
GG is the call. Empire, not only have they beaten VG Gaming, they have won. I'd watch them in the grand final.
That's a 2-0 in the most dominant fashion that you can think of. VG Gaming had probably the best start that you're going to see in quite some time. And man, they're just overwhelmed over there as Empire. I mean, give it up for them. They absolutely deserve this win.
They should be so proud. The way they played, the quality of their supports, and the fact that you're also that far behind from VG Gaming. Like, it was 7.5k behind from VG Gaming. And then you're capable of not only bringing that back, but so commandingly bringing that back. That, for me, was the biggest thing.
Yeah, so a dominant performance put up by Empire, but give it up for Vici as well, being able to fight their way back into the finals. And I think this is going to be actually a good thing for them in the sense that this should act as a wake-up call for Vici Gaming, that other teams have caught up.
Definitely. I mean, really, at the beginning, it did look like this is going to be the game for VG Gaming, but then at the 13 minutes mark, that was this massive fight at Roche. And that really felt like they used that momentum to get back into the game, and then stuff just fell into place for them. Do you also feel like that was a turning point, or do you feel like there could have been other possibilities for them as well?
Oh, absolutely. I think it was entirely the Roche fight. Like, the momentum completely changed from that point on. I know you guys were watching that game, and I was like, in my mind, I was like, okay, this game's over. Maybe Empire should just call it fast so they don't lose their mentality too badly. Like, just call it really quickly, go to the next game, forget about this one. And then that Roche fight happened.
No, I totally agree. I think the Roche fight was definitely a turning point of that game. You know, like, Yoki kind of went for an all-in play there. He just... I have to make something happen. If we give up that Roshan, we're going to lose the game no matter what.
Yeah, exactly.
So we go for that play. We give them the chance that, you know, like, we don't know what happens, but it turned out in their favor completely. I was, like, looking at the Roshan. It was sitting on, like, 5 HP somewhere there. I'm like, just get that last hit. Go for it. But no, they ignored the Roshan totally. Then Queen of Pain got the last hit onto the Roshan, got the Aegis as well, but it did not matter.
Yep.
In fact... Sure, the chunk of experience left for the heroes that were still alive on the lineup of Vici, you know, like, they got that experience, but in the end, you get it back as well.
Feel free to jump.
Yes. Let's bring him in.
Come on in. Here is a microphone for you. First of all, congratulations. That was absolutely a blast to watch those games. You guys looked incredibly happy yesterday already after you won the first two games against VG. Now you did it again, and you came out on top. Did you expect that at all, or is that a big surprise for you guys as well?
Of course not. We are going for top two this tournament, but we was playing so good, so that's why
that's why you won. Yeah, exactly. So, guys, anything you want to ask?
I want to ask, how is Aloha Dance feeling after his performance during the tournament? Because I know we're all very, very, very impressed with his Disruptor. So, is he
was so good at Disruptor. I don't know. how can be so good on this hero?
Did you feel like the other team should have banned Disruptor out after seeing how he performed on him before that?
Of course not. He can show best game on... another support like Rubik or something.
I felt like overall, going into these two games, I felt like there was not, to me, like personally, there was not one player that really shined, but I felt like the team effort in itself, every single person contributed to this win. Do you agree with that?
Yeah, I feel so.
Watching those games, pretty much everyone here felt like you guys really knew how to counter VG in those games, and it really felt like you especially prepared going up against VG. Was that the case? Did you, like, beforehand actually go through replays and make a proper game plan against that
no,
team?
No, we just playing our game, that's all.
Seemed to work out for you guys just fine. So yeah, that must give you a massive confident boost now. Of course, like, you guys have been invited directly to TI. Congratulations to that. How do you feel they're going to place there after you took down the most dominant team at the moment?
We'll boot camping like for 2 months before TI, and I hope so. We will train a lot and can show our best game in the international.
Well, and we can't wait to watch those games. So thanks a lot for joining us once more. Congratulations. Those guys just won this lovely event. D2CL Season 5 LAN Finals are over. We once more want to thank everyone for tuning in, for watching. It's been an absolute blast. Thanks, guys, for casting and analyzing. It's been great to have all of you here on the desk. And, of course, we also want to quickly thank the sponsors, Twitch as well as G2A, for making the whole thing possible. And with that, we're going to peace out, and we hope you guys enjoyed it. Thanks a lot for watching, and goodbye.
Goodbye.
Thank you.